Hello everyone and welcome to B2B Purchase interactive session on India's earth-moving equipment revolution is here. The India infrastructure is estimated to grow at a CAGR of approximately 7% during the next 5 years. The National Infrastructure Pipeline Scheme entered its second year in FY21 and about 42% of the NIP projects are under implementation according to market reports. Another 19% is under development stage, while 31% is still in conceptual stage. This project is a huge capital expenditure in infrastructure in India, and in the coming years, and earth-moving equipment is going to hold a significant share of this investment. So delegates, it's an honor and privilege for me to introduce you to our distinguished speakers. Mr. S.P. Rajan, Head Plant and Machinery L&T Construction, Mr. P.K. Thakur, Head Plant and Equipment, GR Infra Projects Limited, Mr. Jay Kumar B. Kamath, Head Road Machinery Business and L&T Construction and Mining Machinery, and Mr. Pavan Kumar, Chief General Manager, BEML Limited.
The recent Off-Highway Research report indicates record sales of hydraulic excavators in India in the coming 2 years. So how is this, depend or how is the overall earth moving equipment market doing currently in this scenario, and what is your outlook on the market growth? Mr. Kamath, can you tell me something about this?
In fact, when there was the first lockdown, things really looked bad because there was a lot of uncertainty and projects had got stalled. There was a lot of disruption in the supply chain. The second lockdown, people were much better prepared. And currently, though the overall market size is still a shade below what it used to be before the COVID outbreak, the outlook is very positive because all this infrastructure spend which the government is announcing and which is actually happening, it's going to happen only through use of more and more construction equipment. So the market surely in the next few years is going to boom. And like I said, the projections are that it will grow by 10 to 15% annually, which means the size will almost become 3 times by the end of the decade.
Yes. Yeah, definitely. Thank you, Mr. Kamath, for that update. As you mentioned, infrastructure activities is picking up at its speed at a very high momentum. So definitely it's equipment, earth moving equipment has its, chance to perform and excel in the coming years. Thank you so much. And let us know from Mr. Pavan Kumar on the market trend from a mining perspective. What is the demand trend from mining sector for earth moving equipment?
As far as mining industry is concerned, as I have already spoken, that there is a rising trend. And I should not say that COVID, it's bad to, we do not want that COVID should happen again or something, it should increase. But particularly during last year, after when this first quarter, it was completely washed away by COVID happenings, government has given a lot of thrust for the CapEx spending. Those they wanted to boost the economy of India, and also a lot of thrust was given on mining sector, and particularly government sector, maybe Coal India or Steel Authority and NTPC. All the people, they were given a big thrust, and including some of the private industry, that what CapEx should be increased. So in the last year, there was a lot of thrust from the government on CapEx spending, and of course they placed good orders. And in the current year also, that movement is still there. That momentum, it is still on, and all the bigger government customers still, they continue to place the orders. Their demands are getting freezed, you can say, in a record time, which I think earlier years it was not happening so fast. So in the coming days also, it is expected that this boom will continue. At least what I have told, ki another up to 2030, I think we should not worry much. Of course, Mal Hicks and those will continue to come. We need to overcome. And construction equipment, of course, we need not to worry much, because we need to develop a lot, and the government's agenda, and we should be 5 million trillion company by 2025, and it is going to give a very good boost, including construction and mining equipments.
Yes, Pavan sir, that is very positive. And as you said, boom in mining is a boom for all the industries sooner or later. I have a question to Rajan sir. Rajan sir, even Mr. Thakur also replied to one of the delegates about this. It's about the trends in renting, equipment rent. Like Mr. Thakur was sharing with that delegate that equipment renting will be always an evergreen business. And especially when you look at the way how the technology is rapidly improving, or you can say hybrid equipments are coming, electric equipments are coming, innovations are happening at the at that stage. How do you see the growth of equipment renting in India? And being a large player in this industry, do you prefer to go for rented equipment rather than going for owning your own equipment?
If you ask me, rented equipment market now is localized. But days are not far from the neighboring countries or from other overseas also to come and play a big role over here, because they are turning corporate. I'm finding many people having more than 500 machines in their kitty. They are going big way. And I'm just looking at a kind of equipment bank available in the corner of your this thing. By press of a button, it can work for 10 days over here, 10 days in another place, and it keeps going on. Even now, when we take an equipment, we just don't take an equipment for one project. We just say that it's with us and we may use it in any other place. Having said this, this rental market is a mix of the good players, capable players, and also the small players. In days to come, the small players may slowly vanish, because many companies have come up with the age bar related issues, and then even the clients are insisting on particular age for the equipment. So only the new particular equipment with particular age only will exist in the market, and other machines may go to some third world countries. This is something what I'm seeing. Second, they are also very, very keen to utilize the technology to their favor as well as to the client's favor. They want all logging. They want their equipment to perform, and it has to earn for them. So they are keen on working on productivity base also. So if you go for piling, how many meters? If you go for earthwork, how many cubic meters? So something like that, the trend is changing, right? There are many people in the market who are willing to give batching plants and hot mix plants also on rental. So it's there to stay. And all the manufacturers have a separate track for them. Finance companies go after them. Believe me, that is a future. Okay, coming to us, whether we need to maintain or what it is. See, we need to look at strategic equipment, which if a rental company has, they'll not be able to survive. Say, for example, hot mix plant by a rental company will be a problem, because they may not probably continuously get a job for that. That kind of equipment will be with us. And as I was telling, the project cycle is getting squeezed like anything. For that, if I go for buying, the capex procedure, and by the time the equipment reaches my project will be over. The rental source is the best source for me. So rental is there to stay, and larger organizations may utilize it in a very, very big way. and the manufacturers may rather enjoy them more than the real users.
I'm sure equipment renters must be very happy to hear you, both of you. Thakur sir, what is your strategy towards equipment procurement? How do you deal it presently?
The day by day, that when the lot of big projects are coming up, and means we as in GR Infra, we are very, our equipment bank is very big, means compared to our project size and turnover size. So we normally use our own equipment, but yes, of course, to meet the peak requirements, when demand is very high all of a sudden and we need to meet the requirement of our project vision completion stage, and we have to meet the target. So in that situation, we need to augment the equipment from rental sites also. So, but in spite of that, we find that in terms of volume or revenue, I would say, our ratio is something about 80-20 sort of thing. It means 80% we are using our own equipment, or something about 20% we rent out to the market. But well, so far as strategy is concerned, our policy is drafted in such a way. If it is any critical equipments, as Mr. Rajan indicated, of course we do purchase our own, where quality is which directly associated with the quality of the construction. We don't rely on the market rented equipment, so where we have the business. It means it's in fact a I'll say trust deficit issue also with the rental machineries, or some very specialized equipment is required, like the soil stabilizers are there, which are very less in number in the market for rental ability, or some sort of piling rigs are there, which is which we are using in marine projects. So in that cases, we normally own our own equipments, but yes, general equipments, which are like the road construction, excavators, rollers, and similar associated equipments, like pick and carry cranes or backhoe loaders, these type of equipments, of course, we take on rental basis. But one thing I must indicate here, earlier, the size and capacity of the equipments, which were smaller in nature, I'll say, these are getting nowadays, means we are moving towards higher capacity size in road projects also. Because earlier the road project size itself was a total volume of 500 crores or 300 crores like that. Now, bagging a project of 200 crore or 2000 crores or 2500 crores is a very simple thing. Many projects are in such a bigger quantum is this, so that the equipment requirement is also bigger, capacity requirement is also bigger. And for that type of equipments, still availability of equipments is less in the market. So we need to import those type of equipment, and there is still a vacuum for those type of equipments. For example, in greenfield projects, if I say, for even in compaction field, as Mr. Kamath was indicating, we find a need of 16-ton or 17-ton soil compactor to reduce the time of the compaction. So, but in market, still this is lesser in number. So that type of requirement is still available, which can be fulfilled either by OEMs or by rental companies also.
Yes, then. Mr. Thakur, thank you so much for updating on the these aspects. Mr. Kamath, I have a question to you. The market is impacted with the growing steel and fuel cost, as new emission norms also adding to the operational cost and also the manufacturing cost of equipment. So in this scenario, what are the challenges faced by earthmoving equipment market in terms of input cost, manufacturing cost and all? Mr. Kamath.
So, Mr. Sudhir, it's like this. This is something which has hurt all the manufacturers, but it's hurt all the manufacturers equally. I think steel is used by everybody. Fuel is a charge which hurts the common man as well as all the manufacturers. So the challenge is to try and pass on as much of this cost increase as possible to the actual end user. We had a session where the cabinet minister, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, said we should look at how we can bring down the usage of steel in the equipment by innovatively looking at alternate materials. He also said we need to innovate and look at how alternate fuels can be thought of. So blending of ethanol is one method, and in the long run, surely electric vehicles is yet another. But in the short run, passing on as much of cost increase to the customer is the way forward. And I'm sure there's no other option, because cost increase is a reality, and this is being faced by all the manufacturers.
Okay. So definitely all this cost increase is a we can say kind of a norm, like it will go on. Then we have to bring
it. It is not that it will go on and on, because if you look at the steel prices for last 2 months, they haven't really started. They were increasing. The increase has stopped now. So it's okay. Not that the increase will keep happening. So, and it's a commodity cycle. So we can also see I'm not an expert in this, but we might also see the steel prices softening. So that when we don't know when that will happen, but the current reality is the costs have gone up steeply, both on account of steel and on account of fuel prices. And these will require to be passed on to customers. I think all manufacturers are trying hard to convince customers to partake some part of this cost increase.
Mr. Rajan, can you give a closing statement for this session?
Oh, I didn't think, I was not prepared for it, but anyway, I've been almost I'm in touch with Mr. Thakur, Mr. Kamath, and Mr. Pawan also. I heard a couple of times. And our thoughts do merge, and we are very happy to be part of this kind of session where we are able to share our thoughts and then globally bring in a common thought process among the construction industry, right? The construction equipment industry. Having said that, yes, Sudhir is also not a new man to me. I'm in touch with him for almost more than a decade. And he's been contributing. He was contributing from another capacity, and he has taken up this very challenging assignment. And I know he's bringing a lot of people together and creating a kind of a disruption in the industry in a positive way, right? We are here. We are there to support him 100% to spread the positivity in the industry. And I really appreciate. What Mr. Nair as well as Ms. Kulin and Gurlin, right? Gurlin Kaur, for taking time to bring all of us together and making it a really good event. I appreciate them, and I wish them all the best to take this forward. Thank you. And Mr. Nair, for you also for devising this very nice small module which has helped us all to just take this particular time off, come together. And share our thoughts. I have my appreciations for that also. Thank you very much. All the best to you all.
We hope you enjoyed the session. Before wrapping up today's session, we would like to thank our distinguished panelists, Mr. S.P. Rajan, Mr. P.K. Thakur, Mr. Jay Kumar Kamath, and Mr. Pawan Kumar. I would also like to thank our executive editor of B2B Purchase Magazine, Mr. Sudhir, and our editor, Mr. Prasad Nair, for taking this initiative. So with this, we would like to announce the closing of today's session. I request you to stay tuned for more such sessions. Thank you and goodbye.